Okay, so we have some fight talk coming in today. We're continuing on with our introduction to tokenomics, focusing for the time being on the theoretical perspective. Last time, I set out the case for taking an economics-first approach to defining tokenomics. I proposed it that we view it as the design, analysis, and management of assets, financial instruments, markets, and economic systems that have been built using blockchain technology. This definition is broad and reaches all the way up and down the economic scale. But whatever specific problem area we happen to be dealing with, value is always going to be a central concern for our analysis and design objectives. And that's because value is the key driver behind behaviors and decision-making that move economic activity. To be able to design and assess how our tokenomic systems work, we need a theory of value, and one that's rich enough to inform how our tokenomic design choices and the actions of token users interact to affect these value properties. But before we get to that task proper, I think we need to engage with some of the skeptical claims that are frequently leveled at crypto and blockchain. In particular, criticisms that deny that digital assets possess or sustain any real intrinsic value at all. This is a serious charge because it denies the viability of tokenomics as a positive enterprise, instead relegating it to trickery and Ponzi rigging. If this were a marginal view, we could save ourselves some time and skip it. But beliefs like these remain widespread and are still emphatically expressed by intelligent and experienced professionals like those you see here. Anytime that I step outside my own little crypto bubble, I'm reminded of how much of a grip this portrayal still has on people's impressions of blockchain. But moreover, there is a substantial issue underlying these skeptics' charge that we as blockchain proponents need to be able to answer. No blockchain believer can credibly argue that the wild price swings we see in these charts reflect careful responses to new information about fundamental value. Speculation is rife, and some projects do resemble Ponzis, whether by deliberate design or not. In order to convince professionals and business leaders that blockchain-based economic engineering offers real and durable value potential, and in order to equip ourselves to avoid repeating the same mistakes, it's worth our while to look directly at what has gone wrong and look ahead at how we're going to do it better. Just before we do, let's check in with some quick definitions here. Ponzinomics takes its name after those infamous Ponzi schemes. In the classic scheme, investors are lured into an investment and their funds are used to pay returns to investors who got there earlier, while administrators take their cut, of course. It is fraudulent in the exact sense of the word. Administrators know what is going on and intentionally misrepresent and deceive investors. The only way that this can continue on going is if more investors are recruited to keep on funding the concentrated returns of the investors who came in earlier. When it comes to Ponzinomics, some commentators try to counter the charge by saying that blockchain projects don't meet these narrow criteria, and so are not Ponzis. But this is obviously missing the point. The fundamental issue with Ponzis is that there isn't enough value to go around. No additional source of value is growing or being created that, under some arrangement, could leave everyone taking part better off. This more general characterization of a Ponzi scheme is describable as a zero-sum or negative-sum game. These terms come from game theory, where they have a strict mathematical definition. But they are also used figuratively by politics and economics commentators to describe situations where people can only win by others losing. It is in this figurative sense that we're going to be exploring Ponzinomic designs. That doesn't require us to make assumptions about the developer's intent or what they communicated to investors, nor does it limit us to specifics about the way that value is transferred. Good, so let's get going. To improve our understanding of what makes a bad or Ponzinomic design, we're going to make use of the classic model of supply and demand. There are worthwhile things to say about how and why we can make use of this model to analyze digital asset value, but we'll do that in the next lecture. For the moment, it's enough to say that this model makes clear that supply and demand both influence value. It helps organize our thinking and get helpful insights by examining whether the effects are acting on the supply side or the demand side. And finally, the model retains its familiar and intuitive relationships in a blockchain context. If demand increases, prices go up. If supply increases, prices go down, etc. We'll use this framework to shed light on the nature of tokenomic weaknesses and failures by explaining them as effects on supply or demand. In some cases, we'll see that supply and demand interact with each other. Certain supply characteristics can influence the type of demand that is attracted, for example. But when we look at failed and unsustainable projects to date, their fundamental problems are most clearly revealed when examined on the demand side. This fits in with my own observation that there hasn't been enough demand-focused design and analysis in blockchain generally. I suspect that this is partly the legacy of Bitcoin's success, which built its demand case out of one salient economic feature, a finite supply. That may have fostered a lasting overemphasis on the importance of supply fundamentals as determinants of value. But it's also fair to recognize that demand is genuinely a harder problem to get a handle on. Tokenomic tools give you lots and lots of ways to exert direct control on scarcity and supply, but they don't give you direct control over what people want or feel. Those are the factors that ultimately underlie demand. And to be clear, nothing we're going to discuss in the material ahead will ever grant you these powers. But by thinking a little more directly and attentively about demand, we can exercise greater care in planning ahead, making a serious, deeper effort to consider how demand may be affected and react to our designs. So let's start making our way there by looking at three categories of demand that blockchain projects can tap into. So first, logically speaking, we can have demand that is driven by the opportunity for speculative gain, and the alternative, demand that's driven by other needs, wishes, and fulfillments. Taking that second category, we can split that in two as well, to distinguish between utilities that are created by features that are blockchain-specific, meaning that they can only be built with the help of blockchain technology, or that blockchain confers some important advantage over alternative implementations. Then there are other features that attract demand, which have nothing to do with blockchain, but can still be very important or substantial. This could include things like exciting gameplay or a new social media experience. So these are the three possibilities, and they are logically exhaustive, but they are not exclusive to each other. A project may attract demand with features that touch upon all three. So with the help of these definitions, I'm now going to propose that projects which have unsustainable value will often feature one or more of these red flags on the demand side. In first instance, we have the case where speculation is the only utility. In fact, we still have a problem when speculation becomes the dominant utility because those speculators can overthrow the project for everybody else. Next, we have projects where there are no blockchain-specific features driving sustainable demand. This second weakness is not as fatal as the first. It is conceivable that a strong sustainable demand case is built entirely out of non-blockchain features, with blockchain only being used to offer generic conveniences like token ownership. But it's my view that such projects are going to have an increasingly harder time going forward. Seasoned investors are already turning down projects that don't present a strong token utility case. That's a compelling explanation of why a token is going to be useful. And it's only a small shift from there to ask founders to justify why they need to use blockchain at all. By comparison, projects which do make purposeful and distinctive use of blockchain capabilities are likelier to have more robust and better defended demand bases that investors stand to benefit from, because in principle, those features won't be able to be implemented any other way. Okay, let's now look at some common red flags on the supply side. First is the use of very simple and generic supply design. The standard sale and IDO format in use today typically sets a maximum supply, partitioning that into allocations, and then sets schedules for these allocations to be released to their respective parties over time. These are essential elements of token design, and they are vital for bringing startup capital, talent, and users on board. They are not trivial or easy to execute well. That's why the main part of this course is going to be dedicated to exploring the detail and intricacy of this task. However, if this is where tokenomic design stops, that can be a problem. It means no effort or care has been invested in creating more thoughtful dynamic supply features, nor any effort to apply tokenomics to attract demand. Unfortunately, this bare minimum approach seems to have been very commonplace, and many people mistakenly think that these allocation and distribution charts is all there is to tokenomics. Back to our list of red flags then. Another one worth looking out for are supply mechanics which amplify or reward speculation. In a sense, this is just the opposite problem to the one I just mentioned. Here, a project is offering us a more creative use of mechanisms and policies to manage supply. But the way they perform in practice only fans the flames of speculative demand. We'll have a look at some specific examples in a second. A third common red flag is to use supply to fund badly designed rewards in a bid to attract new users. Such rewards are badly designed when they are not limited by a carefully considered budget, or when they entrench ongoing payment commitments that are not matched by value growth created by the reward claimants or other actors in the economy. Therefore, they erode value through inflation. These features also attract their own kind of poor quality speculative demand. Since users are attracted by the indiscriminate payouts, typically only caring about the rewards and selling at the first opportunity they have in order to cash out. Okay, so now that we've detailed some common risks to be on the lookout for, let's see how they show up in specific case study assessments for three high-profile collapses